seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased their joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest. Lord,
you promise light to those who dwell in darkness. Let your light brighten our world.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Show me the way I should go. For to you
pray for the peace of Jerusalem.
May they prosper who love you.
Peace be within your walls.
And quietness within your towers.
For my brethren and companions' sake,
I pray for your prosperity.
Because of the house of the Lord our God,
I will seek to do you good.
Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
On the Mount of Olives, Jesus said to his disciples privately about his coming. But about that day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day Noah entered the ark, and they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away. So too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field, one will be taken, and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together, one will be taken, and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
It's like we're trying to do this thing to add anticipation each week as we approach that day when we celebrate the birth of Christ. You'll notice in our scripture readings in Advent, we don't hear about shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. We don't hear about Mary and Joseph on their way to Bethlehem, riding a donkey, looking for a place to stay. Today, on the first Sunday of Advent, you'll note that the gospel is a warning that we need to be ready for the coming of the Son of Man. The coming of Jesus that we talk about in Advent is not about a baby being born in a manger, the Savior that the world has longed for. Instead, we hear about a time that is still coming, a time still ahead of us, the end of times, when the Son of Man will come in clouds with great power and glory. We hear about that great day when he will send out his angels and gather his elect from the four winds and the ends of the earth to the ends of the heaven. In Advent, we hear about Jesus and his eventual return and the importance of being prepared. Jesus warns that we will not know when he will return, so we're to keep awake. We're to be ready. Jesus had already foretold his suffering and persecution to his disciples, and now he's preparing for them what is about to happen in Jerusalem. And it's not going to be a pretty picture. But even though Jesus paints an ugly picture about the days ahead concerning the imminent future, we should not overlook the fact that the Son of Man will return. And this is what Advent is all about. This promise that Jesus will come again. It's about also seeing the world as it is. It's about seeing the world not as a perfect place, but a place where we experience injustice and strife and war and hatred and oppression. A world in need of redemption. And Jesus promises us that redemption. In Advent, we're waiting for it. But he's not left us with our challenges alone. When I was growing up, I heard a lot of preaching about this wicked world that we live in. And although there is evil and hate in the world, I do not believe that the world itself is wicked. The world that we live in was created by God, and God has not deserted us. Jesus came to live among us because God loves us, not only to throw us a lifeline and rescue us from a sinking ship. Jesus comes to bring life and health to all of us. I believe in these passages that we hear about in Advent, and this one, Jesus presents for us today. He's talking about his coming again. It's not to be taken so literally that we assume that Jesus is not with us now. Jesus speaks poetically about the end times. The Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory at an unexpected hour. But it doesn't mean that we need to hide in fear and trembling. All throughout the Bible, even in the Old Testament, we hear promises that God made again and again and again to the prophets of old, that one day God would make everything all right. This is presented as a day of judgment. We hear about that day, but that's not what we ought to focus on today. Not about the judgment, but about God's promise to make all things right. So, in our modern day, and today, when we hear these scriptures, rather than think we ought to sit patiently and wait for that day when Christ will come and save us from this wicked world, it's time to get ready. It's time to get busy. It's time to wake up. Jesus promised to use his authority on earth to make things right. And the authority of Jesus is love. Love for all creation. Love for us. Love for our neighbors. Love for God. Keep awake. Being ready, that means to be present with people, especially when they are in need. Being present with people who need the love of God in their lives. We need to be ready to share God's love with others, the poor and the hungry. Jesus says that when we feed the hungry, we are feeding him. When we refuse to feed those in need, we are refusing to help him. Keep awake. Be ready. Sometimes as Advent approaches and we hear all these end time stories, it can come to us not so much as a shock as something that feels familiar. If we have experienced some great loss in our lives recently, it may feel like the end of the world for us. The ending of one's personal world is not the same as the end of the world that Jesus describes in the gospel today. Yet, the first Sunday of Advent invites us to recognize that these endings are connected. That the Christ who will return at the end of time somehow inhabits each ending that we experience in our lives. Each year, Advent calls us to practice the apocalypse, to look for the presence of Christ who enters into every loss, who comes to us in the midst of devastation, who gathers us up when our world has shattered, and who offers healing that is a foretaste of the wholeness that he's working to bring about, not only at the end of time, but also now, in this place, in our lives, in our homes, in our hearts. As this Advent begins, is there something in your life that is ending? How might you look for the presence of Christ who comes to you in that place? In our reading from Romans, Paul tells us that salvation is near. We are to lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. We are to live our lives today and every day ready to receive Christ at his coming, ready to be the hands and feet of Jesus in this world, putting off our darkness, putting on his light, sharing the light and the love and the grace and the joy of Jesus Christ with the dark places of the world. Putting on his armor so that we are kept from being overcome with the darkness. Advent is a time of preparation. It's a time of anticipation. We may not know when God will make everything right in this world, but I believe that God is making things right, even now, through each one of us. So if we just sit around waiting for his return, we fail to see that God is with us and in us and working through us. We have been given the spiritual gifts we need to be strong in our faith, to act courageously by doing God's will and making things right in this world every way we can. Preparing for Jesus is preparing for God's kingdom. By trusting God's promise and by doing our part to make this a better world. Today, as we begin this new year, and as we look into our hearts, let us pray that God will help us use our gift of faith to support one another on this journey, and to use what God has given us to make this a better world. A brighter world with the love of Christ in it. And if we're doing that, we will be ready when Christ comes in all of his glory and power. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. you are visiting with us for the first time, we are delighted that you're here. We ask that you complete a visitor's card that you'll find in front of your pew and give it to the ushers when they come up with a plate. And we hope you'll stay for a time of fellowship on the front lawn after worship is over. There are announcements in your bulletin for you to take note of. Christmas is not far away, and we are really getting ready for Christmas in a variety of ways. We will have a parish Christmas party coming up in a few days, December 13th, our parish Christmas party. We have a tradition of getting together once a year in the homes of our parishioners, and this year that party is being hosted by Chris and Ken Henson. They live just a few blocks from here on Broadway. If you've never been to one of our parish Christmas parties, I strongly encourage you to come. It's a wonderful, uplifting, fun, joyful time to meet the people that you go to church with. And there are plenty of people here that you don't know, I promise you, that go to this church. And the Christmas party is a wonderful time to raise a glass and get to meet a new friend and to spend time with old friends too. So please come to that. Bring an appetizer to share. It's also the season of giving. We have an angel tree that's set up in the foyer. We are collecting gifts to give to the residents of House of Time and Trinity House. There may be a few of those gift opportunities left on the tree. If so, take one and bring it back according to the instructions. Our youth group is collecting Christmas ornaments to decorate the trees at the Trinity House shelter. So if you're inclined to help them buy some Christmas ornaments, please do that and make it to the office this week. I think Joseph has it.
Our new choir CD is in process right now. Hopefully it will be on its way to us this next week. It would make a wonderful surprise, unique Christmas gift to friends and family and clients. So we encourage you to sign up in advance for those. I'll be at the secretary's desk outside of the main office following this service, taking names for today. Thank you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in Him of everlasting life, that when He shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold His appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is alive.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling His death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in Him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament, and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by Him and with Him and in Him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we have only to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not
into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Oh,
peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always.